Good morning, and welcome to New Covenant Church. My name is Chris Castaldo. I serve as lead pastor. We are delighted to gather together as God's people. New Covenant is dedicated to seeing Christ preached from all of Scripture, love extended to the church, the city, and the world, and lives transformed by the power of the gospel. We are delighted to have the great organist from Switzerland, Loic Berkey, who's traveling through the United States, and as I understand it, he said, "I just have to play the organ at New Covenant Church in Naperville." Welcome, Loic. Such a privilege to have you with us. And today is the day when we are collecting our filled baby bottles. If you have been in the process of gathering coins to benefit the Caring Network, then we'd be delighted to get that from you and give it to the ministry. If perhaps you don't have it this morning, no problem. We'll be prepared to collect them next week as well. I want to thank you personally for the time off I have enjoyed over the last several weeks, a combination of vacation and some study time. This past week, I was in Oak Park, Illinois, at our annual Center for Pastor Theologian gathering. And this is an organization that is dedicated to equipping pastors to be theologians in today's complex world. And for the last 8 years, I've enjoyed gathering with like-minded pastors to think deeply about the challenges that are facing God's people today and how we can navigate them with the gospel at the leading edge of all that I do. Pastor O'Donnell also belongs to CPT, and I'm sure he would agree. One of the highlights happens in the morning. We gather at 8 a.m. in the sanctuary of Oak Park, and there, through that beautiful stained glass, the morning light shines, and about 15 to 20 pastors pray and sing and enjoy the morning liturgy together. And as we were singing this past week, I thought, all of that work is in service of what we are to do right now. It's for the church. It's for the people of God who gather week by week and lift their voice in worship of the living God. And so what we're doing now is of ultimate significance. Well, with that calling before us, I'd like to begin our service with the words of Psalm 134. Come, bless the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, who stand by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who made heaven and earth.
Please stand as we sing our hymn of adoration, Rejoice, Ye Pure in Heart.
Your best, O banner. Christian, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the redemption of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
In 2006, I traveled to Krakow, Poland, to help my friend Rico Tice with a Christianity Explored conference. While there, I had the pleasure of meeting students from all around the world. It was a German student, an Irish student, and even an Italian student. And I was so excited, you know, the Italian from New York who talks ad nausea about Italian things. I have a real live Italian in front of me. So here he was, this sort of prematurely balding kid with a very handsome face, very earnest about his faith and his desire to reach the lost. We developed a friendship. And he said, if you're ever in Italy, be sure to let me know, because my mother would love to extend hospitality. Well, we took him up on that. Angela was pregnant with our son Simeon, and we visited Marco Salin there in Tuscany and his lovely parents, Gianni and Licia, had us over for dinner. Well, it was shortly thereafter that Gianni and Licia visited the States for a sabbatical. They have a ministry of counseling to families and couples called Insieme, which means together in Italian. I've described them in the past as the James and Shirley Dobson of Italy, but with a lot more style and personality. And so we had the joy of having them with us for 3 months. And then their son, Marco, met a lovely, godly young woman named Federica and got married. And they decided to come to Chicago to study at the Moody Bible Institute, during which time Angela and I again enjoyed sweet fellowship with them. And then in the fullness of time, they came here to New Covenant Church to serve as in an internship. And Marco worked with our youth and taught and preached and so many other things. And so it was very natural at that point to say, how can we support you? And it's been a great privilege doing that as a church over these last few years. And so it is my great joy to introduce to you our friend Marco and Federica as they give us a little highlight of their ministry, and then we'll have Elder Carl Pennings come and pray for them. Welcome.
Good morning, everyone. So good to be back after 5 long years, as I like to say, 3 years and a pandemic. For those of you who remember us, I'm sure you were missing our Italian accent and our mispronounced words. For those of you who don't know us, if you hear funny words, they're probably mispronounced words. And I'm sure the youth have a long list of funny things that I've said in the 2 years serving here. So we left New Covenant Church in 2017, right after Isabel was born and she was dedicated here. And since then, we've been serving in Italy in the city of Bologna. Bologna is pretty much close to Florence. Maybe you know Florence more than Bologna. And since we've moved back to Italy, almost nothing has gone according to our plans. Almost nothing has looked the way we anticipated. And yet we've seen God move in remarkable and astonishing ways. It's hard to give you a full picture of what we've been doing for the past 5 years and what our lives look like on a daily basis. For that, we invite you to the James's next Saturday. We're going to have a lovely night, Italian food, and a short presentation of our ministry. But we would like to share two quick stories, two quick testimonies that explain what our lives look like and what our ministry is all about. So Italy is considered a country unreached by the gospel. Evangelical churches are very few and very small, and sharing the gospel is very challenging. So I serve as a pastor of a local church, and since the church doesn't have the means to support us, and since when we left, we only got to 40% of the support we needed. In 2018, I've started working as a freelance nurse, which is what I used to do before going to seminary. And I work an average of 30 hours per week. And again, this situation is not ideal, is not what I was expecting, but God has been using this for his glory. So the first story goes like this. When I started working, I met this grouchy colleague of mine called Francis. Very, very few words. One of those people that you think you will never be able to share the gospel with. You know, very, very hard to talk to him. And so for the first few months, I exchanged only a few words with him. And then in 2019, I had this idea. I organized my birthday party in the church building, and I invited all of my colleagues to come to my birthday party. And I asked the congregation, some of our friends, to serve at that party. And so Francesco and his girlfriend Caterina came, and they were so impressed, they had such a lovely night, that we were able afterwards to invite them at an event for couples, young couples at our church. And again, they really loved it. And slowly we understood that Caterina was open to the gospel, we understood that Francesco would define himself as an atheist, but really, it's not that he doesn't believe in God, it's that he's upset, he's mad with God because his mom died when he was a kid. So, as many things happened, we kept talking, we kept inviting them to church, and in the last March, Francesco and Caterina, one Sunday morning, show up for a Sunday service. They attended the service, and after the service, Caterina told Federica, I want to get baptized. I want to become a part of this church. And so on August 21st, we're going to go back to Italy, and on August 26th, I'm going to celebrate the wedding. And the amazing thing is that at that wedding, most of my colleagues are going to be there, and I'm going to have a chance to preach the gospel in front of them. It's not what we anticipated, it's not what we planned for, but God is moving in miraculous ways, and it's really sweet. And we want to thank you, New Covenant, for believing in us and supporting us so that, you know, we can be part of stories like the story of Francesco and Caterina.
Italy is not only an unreached country. Italy is one of the first destinations for human trafficking in Europe. And it counts around 120,000 victims of sex trafficking. 80% of these women are from Nigeria, and only 2% of them are rescued. I am one of the co-leaders of the Vite Trasformate ministry, in English is Transformed Lives. It's a ministry that fights the widespread issue of sex trafficking, sexual exploitation in Italy. Hope, fictitious name, told us a story. I was standing by the side of the road in my high heels. It was cold. I was tired. That night, I cried out to God, please help me. And then I saw you walking toward me with hot tea and cookies. That night, I decided to trust you. Today, Hope has a regular job, got a driver's license, and desires to bring awareness on the issue of trafficking. So again, as Marco said, if you come to the event on Saturday, you will hear more about what Vite Trasformate does, how we reach women in the streets at night who are trafficked in Italy, and especially you will hear about Casa Ruth. It's a project they were working on, a safe house project to offer a place where these women can find 360 restoration. So we hope to see you all, and I hope you are excited to hear more about the ministry that God is doing in Italy.
It's my privilege now to include the Salins in the prayer this morning. Today's prayer is based on Romans 10 and 11. Let us pray. God our Father, we praise you for the depths of your riches, wisdom, and knowledge. How unsearchable are your judgments and how inscrutable your ways. For from you and through you and for you are all things. As we prepare to celebrate communion today, let us confess our sins. We confess our disobedience and unbelief. We confess the times that we do not submit to your righteousness, but instead try to establish our own righteousness without you. We confess that we have not lived by your commandments and are deserving of your wrath and judgment. Please take a moment to silently confess your sins. Thank you, God, that you do not leave us as objects of judgment and wrath, but promise that if we confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in our heart that you raised him from the dead, you bestow the riches of salvation on us through your mercy and grace. We thank you for this message of salvation and pray that it would be in our hearts and minds and on our tongues wherever we go. We thank you for the Salins and their faithful gospel proclamation in Bologna. We pray for your protection over them and for your perfect provision for their needs. We ask for continued prayer and financial support from New Covenant Church and their other partners, for how can they preach unless they are sent? We pray that Nuova Vita Church would be your hands and feet as they take your message to those who have not heard it, for how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. We ask for unity in the core group of their church plant in downtown Bologna and their witness to neighbors and friends. We pray for the people they've impacted for the gospel, that they will call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. We lift up Vita Transformate and ask for growth and unity in their leadership team and progress in the Safe House project. We thank you for successful surgeries for Tom Gephardt and Mary Butler. We ask for healing for Bob and Diane Ohms, Doug Yeo, Grace Canfield, and for all those in our congregation who are hurting, grieving, or struggling with health concerns. We ask that you would speak through Doug O'Donnell this morning, for faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. We close this morning as you taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Morning. I'd like to welcome you again to New Covenant Church and remind you that we provide two ways for you to make your offering to New Covenant. One, through the box at the back of the sanctuary, and the other online at newcovenantnaperville.org. If you are new here to New Covenant or visiting, we invite you to see our information table in the narthex for more information about New Covenant, what we believe, and who we are. Whether you are new or old here, we encourage you to find the friendship pad in the center aisles, fill out your attendance here, pass that down so that each family and individual can be so noted. And finally, children of all ages are always encouraged to stay and worship with us and are welcome to do so. For those who would prefer, we do offer our Wonders of Worship program for children aged 4 through 2nd grade. They will be dismissed after this reading. And now for today's Old Testament scripture. Would you please open your Bible and follow along as I read from the book of Psalms. I will be reading chapter 32. You can find this in the Pew Bible on page 462. Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to you, Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found. Surely, in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Be not like a horse or a mule without understanding, which must be curbed with bit and bridle, or it will not stay near you. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds the one who trusts in the Lord. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart.
Thank you. Today's scripture reading is the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verses 21 through 32. This passage can be found on page 875 in your Pew Bible. After the reading, please remain standing for the singing of the doxology. Now, if you are able, please stand for the reading of God's Word. Page 875, Luke, chapter 15, verses 21 through 32. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate, for this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound." But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, "Look, these many years I have served you. I never disobeyed your command, yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him." And he said to him, "Son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good to be back with you. Someone asked me recently, just last week, how many sermons have you preached over your life? And I said off the top of my head, I don't over 500 for sure. And then as I was thinking about this passage, I've never preached on the parable of the prodigal son. And so I'm super excited because there's a text that kind of preaches itself. You may have wondered why the scripture reading didn't start at verse 11. That is totally my fault. I gave the wrong number. I will cover verse 11 and on. I am dyslexic, especially when it comes to numbers. And my wife will, I once did an illustration on pi, the mathematical term, 3.41, and on I went, and all the mathematicians laughed, and the eighth graders too, whoever was learning pi. So I wrote down 21 when it should have been 11. So we'll cover 11 till the end to 32. Well, let's bow our heads and pray, ask for God's help. Father, what a privilege it indeed is to come to this remarkable, remarkable story. Father, I ask that you would bless me, fill me with your spirit, so that all of us might learn from our Lord Jesus Christ about your amazing grace. We pray in his name, Amen. The story I have heard my mother retell most to others about me as a boy is when I got lost. Or in my view, when she and everyone else looking for me didn't know where to look. I was 4 years old. There was a block party. Near dusk, I wandered back home for a snack. After I raided the fridge, I sat in the corner of the kitchen. When the sun set, the sudden blackness frightened me. My dad, to save electricity, he would turn off every light in the house. I was so scared in that corner, I didn't move. Meanwhile, as this darkness came across the land, my mother did what mothers of five children do. She counted. There's Porrick and Mary and Julie and Matthew. But where's Douglas? She said, "Excuse me," as she was talking to one of her neighbors, and she stepped back to look around. She said, "I don't see Douglas." She next started to walk up and down the street. She checked some of the backyards. And then she came back to the group of adults, and she said, I'm very worried. I've seen all of my kids and all of your kids, but I have not seen Douglas. Well, everyone quickly mobilized after a few minutes, hours, I don't remember. My parents came home, probably to call the police, because the only place you could call the police was at home in those days. And there I was, huddled in the corner of the kitchen. The search was over, the lights were finally turned on, and the whole neighborhood rushed into our small kitchen and celebrated. I was kissed 1,000 times by a bunch of old ladies, women over 30 at that time. The famous parable, The Prodigal Son, it shares a similar plot line. A son is lost, found, and celebrated. And that parable set within the context of two other parables that come before that share the same themes and plot. If you'll open again to Luke 15, I'll show you what I'm saying. In verses 4 through 7, we have the parable of the lost sheep. And you know the story. One sheep out of 100 leaves the flock. The shepherd does his count, likely at night, right before the sun's set, and he notices that Douglas Shawn the sheep is missing. So what does he do? Well, he looks everywhere for the strayed sheep, and once he finds it, he lifts it up, he lays it on his shoulders, and he walks back home. But look at the end of verse 5. Do you see the last word? Rejoicing. He walks back home rejoicing, and he doesn't stop there, does he? The text continues, verse 6. When he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep." Just one sheep he's rejoicing over that was lost. And then our Lord Jesus gives a very brief but brilliant, always brilliant commentary in verse 7. "Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance or who think they don't need to repent." And then next, our utterly brilliant but absolutely humble Lord tells another parable, usually called the parable of the lost coin. And it goes like this. "Once there was a woman who had 10 silver coins." So you might think, cha-ching, that's a lot of money, 10 silver coins. Or if that's all she has to live on, that's not much at all. Or if you understand the nature of what coin she's holding, you'll really realize she doesn't have much at all. The coins were called drachmas, and each one was worth one sheep. So she's got one sheep, or 10 sheep, a day's wages. So she's missing a little bit of a paycheck. So what does she do? Well, she lights and sweeps the house, listening for the sound, looking for the coin. She diligently sweeps until she finds it. "I found it," or "yes," she screams out, I imagine her saying. End of story. No, look down at how Jesus concludes in verses 9 and 10. "And when she had found it, she too, the same as the shepherd, calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice,'" same word, "with me, for I have found the coin I had lost. Just so, I tell you," Jesus tells them and tells us, "there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." Now then, that's the context. Everyone pumped up for the next parable, the really famous parable, to see the same pattern? Good. Sounds like you're pumped up. Sound like Presbyterians, the sound of silence. Our Lord begins, look with me, starting verse 11. There's a man who had two sons. I have two sons, so I emotionally relate to this very well. Sean and Simeon, I love them as much as I love this hand and this hand, this arm and this arm, and maybe even more of my body. I love them. Let's see if this father loves his two sons. Let's see how he feels about them. Well, the younger of them came up to his father and said, "Father, give me the share of property that's coming to me." Now, just pause here. If my youngest, Simeon, sitting in the back over there, 17, if he came to me and said this, I would say, "Excuse me? You want your you want me dead now? Is that what you're asking?" And listen, I've worked my whole life very hard since your age or thereabouts, 18. There's no way I'm giving you right now half of the house, savings, the book royalties, as well as the penthouse in Paris and the beach house in the Bahamas. No way. But what does this father do? That's what a normal father would do. This father, look and wonder and ponder at the end of verse 12, and he divided the property between them, the two sons. This is remarkable. This younger son, with his unreasonable request, is met by the father's unimaginable generosity. What a costly demonstration, says Kenneth Bailey, a costly demonstration of unexpected love. A few days later, verse 13, not many days later, once the lawyers have signed all the paperwork, the younger son gathered what he had. I think a phrase that means he liquidated his assets, his property in a hurry, which means he sold stuff at whatever price because he wanted to just carry a few things with him on his journey. He liquidates everything, and then he takes a journey to the far country, far away from his family, far away from the traditional values of his Jewish faith, into a far country. In Greek, the words are kora makra, literally a big open space, or we might say a great emptiness. He enters a great emptiness, and there and then he squandered, wasted his property and his inheritance in reckless, godless living. Later in verse 30, his brother will claim that his younger brother devoured his property with prostitutes, with sexual sins. That is perhaps true. And if it is true, then he's the embodiment of the ancient book of wisdom called Sirach. Do not give yourself to prostitutes or you will lose your inheritance. And then things went from bad to worse. Verse 14, and when he had spent everything, you sort of wonder, is this 1 year, 2 years, 1 month, 2 months? He spent everything. Then a severe famine arose in the land. Yikes. And then he began to be in need, I'll say. So, verse 15, he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of the country, the great emptiness. Let's see how he treats him. So this boy, he's wallowed in sin for a while. Now he will wallow with the pigs. He went and hired himself out to one of the citizens in the country who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. Now imagine this pagan boss saying to this Jewish boy, who's not allowed to eat pig, by the way, because it's not kosher. It's ceremonially, it's unclean as an animal, according to Old Testament law. "Oh, yes, I'm happy to hire you, but the only job I have left is to feed the pigs. Are you okay with that? Not against your religion or anything?" And the boy says, "I'll take it." And take it he did. He had work, the work of a slave, but no paycheck yet, or not enough to buy enough food. He was hungry, starving. Verse 16, he was longing. In Greek, it's called imperfect verb. It's longing and longing. He was starving. He was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. I'd be longing for the pigs. Some ham and bacon. He was longing for any kind of food. And no one gave him anything. Life in the empty space. These pagans, they were happy probably that this foreigner, this refugee with his strange religion was suffering. No one shared food with him, no one. But then something happened. When he came to himself or to his senses, or when God in his grace came to him, or both, he He thought, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough food, bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise, I will go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. Well, he wasted no time. He acted upon this idea. He arose, he shook off the slop, he came, he walked back to his father. It's interesting, the text doesn't say, and he walked back home, but he walked back to his father. He was repenting by turning from sin and returning to his father. Ah, but what will the father think, feel, say, do when this prodigal tries to execute his plan? Well, Jesus tells us, but while he, the son, verse 20, was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. This is amazing, amazing grace. Now, what to say here? There's so much to say here. I'll just limit it to four observations. First, this father, and it's very interesting, the word father in this parable is used 12 times. This is an important character. This father must have been looking for him out the window or on the front yard or atop the highest point of his property. He must have been looking for, how else could he see him a long way off unless he was waiting and looking? The Father, if you haven't guessed, symbolizes God the Father. And the point being, the point of this picture is that God longs for you. If you've strayed like this son has strayed, he longs for you to leave sin and to come back to him. Listen, our God is not the God of the deists. He created the world, but he doesn't providentially care for it. He's not interested in anything that's going on in the world, including you and me. And he's not some harsh lawmaker slash policeman who knows you can't keep the laws that he gives and can't wait to punish you once you break them. No, our God longs for you if you're like this prodigal son. He longs for you to repent of sin and to come back to him. And second, this father felt something, compassion. Compassion, this word, this emotion, is the emotion that our Lord Jesus Christ most expressed in his earthly ministry, or so the gospel writers use to express his emotions. And he, of course, continues to express over and over in his heavenly ministry as he daily intercedes for us out of compassion. You see, God, Father, Son, and Spirit, is love, the Apostle John wrote. He also wrote that God the Father so loved the world that he sent Jesus, his Son, to die and to live and rise for us. The famous Swiss theologian Karl Barth, who wrote more than any theologian in church history, I believe, it's either him or Aquinas, was asked to summarize near the end of his life what he has learned, maybe in a sentence or two, what he's learned about God through all his ministry, through all his writings, through all his education. And he said this, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And that's right. That's the right answer. He quotes this children's song that is the right answer. God the Father, Son, and Spirit is a God of compassion, deep, emotional, heartfelt love towards us, even us sinners. Third, The father ran to him. In the context of where the story is set, the ancient Middle East, the Near East, for a grown man, especially an older man, especially a well-to-do man, which he was, to pull up his robe, perhaps showing his undergarments and his legs, and to run would be considered uncouth and even somewhat scandalous. Yes, a beautiful, scandalous love is pictured here. I know we're not to picture God as a person, as a human being, but God the Father, but imagine, without sinning, imagine God running to you. God running to you once you've returned to him after your sin, even after your serious sinning streak. And then fourth, imagine the impossible. Hugs and kisses from God. The father of the prodigal, when he saw him in the distance, he ran to him. And as soon as they were face to face, he embraced him and kissed him. The verb in Greek is intensive. It means the father was kissing and kissing. He was kissing and kissing his son. Remarkable, amazing, amazing grace. However, this boy didn't yet get grace. He bowed to the ground, I imagine, and he rehearsed his lines. He said them, "Father, I've sinned against you in heaven and before you." And as he sang his next rehearsed lines, "I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants," the father cries out some commands, either for the distance up the hill or the servants who maybe ran behind him. And he says, "Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand, perhaps the family signet ring, which signified he's my son, he's always been my son, but he also gets the inheritance back. And shoes on his feet, and bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let us eat filet tenderloins from the biggest and healthiest cow, yum. And celebrate, and celebrate. For this, my son," not this new hired servant, "my son, my always son was dead and is alive again, was lost and is found." And they, the whole household, the neighbors too, began to celebrate. You see, here the father offers no corrective sermon like most of us would do, if we're honest. What do you think you're doing? Where's your self-respect? You shamed me, our family, your community, and now you're penniless. You've lost not only your own dignity, but your entire inheritance. Didn't I warn you this would happen? Are you finally ready to listen and obey me? Rather, he, the father, receives the son readily. He pardons him freely. He accepts him completely. The father gave, as one commentator puts it, him the best of everything, expecting nothing in return. The robe of honor, the ring of inheritance, the footwear of freedom, the feast of fellowship. He did all this because he wanted everyone to know that his son was still his son. Now, what's the lesson here? It's simply this: it is fitting to celebrate. It is fitting to celebrate when someone repents and receives forgiveness. Now, this, of course, is what the father does, and we just read that. And it's what he says. It's what he says to the older brother who cannot comprehend such a celebration. The parables end stress in verse 32. It's fitting, it's right, it's the proper thing to do, to celebrate and be glad for this. Your brother was dead in sin and alive. He's returned from his sinning, resurrected, and he was lost. A second set of metaphors, and now he is found. Now, this lesson is not only found here and at the end of the parable, but in the two parables that come before it. We find the same language. We find, as I said earlier, the same plot line in both of those parables, the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin. Something is lost, seven times that word is used, and then found, find or find, eight times, and then celebrated. The words joy, rejoice, rejoicing, be glad, and celebrate are used 10 times. "I tell you the truth," Jesus says in verse 7, and listen again, "there will be more joy in heaven as there should be on earth when one sinner repents." Now, is that your heart? Is that your heart? Do you think it's fitting? Do you think it's fitting to celebrate when someone repents and receives forgiveness? Repents of sins you would never even dream of committing. You see, on one hand, Jesus gives this parable to let the worst sinners imaginable. If that's one of you, welcome to New Covenant Church. Worst sinners imaginable know that if they repent, in the words of the psalmist that we just heard, "I acknowledge my sin to you, God will forgive them. You forgave the iniquity of my sin," and everyone will, or everyone here should celebrate. That psalm ends, "Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous at heart, and shout for joy, all you upright of heart." So on one hand, Jesus gives this parable to let the chief of sinners know that if they come back to God, he will welcome them with open arms. And on the other hand, he lets those who cannot will not even try to grasp God's grace, a warning that if they do not repent of their lack of grace, God will not look kindly upon their unkindness. Now, we know those two audiences are in mind because the context in which Jesus gives this parable is absolutely clear. Look at verses 1 and 2. Now, the tax collectors and sinners were drawing near to him. And we know from other places in scriptures, they not only draw near to him, but they became followers of his. So as they draw near, the Pharisees, next line, and the scribes, the Jewish religious leaders, they backed away, I imagine. They grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." Exactly. If you ever want a phrase for what is the ministry of Jesus, this man receives sinners. That's who Jesus is. This man receives sinners. And more than that, he fellowships with them. He eats with them. So you see, the attitude of the riffraff of the first century Jewish society, tax collectors, other notorious sinners who came to hear from Jesus, they are embodied in this character of the prodigal son. And the proud and pious Jewish religious leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees who grumbled at such grace, are embodied in the prodigal son's older brother, or the father's firstborn son, who we read about next and finally in verses 25 through 32. And Jesus' speech here is so subversive, he's attacking the scribes and Pharisees. Now his older son, verse 25, was in the field, and he came and he drew near the house. He heard music and dancing. Just as an aside, Jesus is for dancing in the church, pro dancing. Not sure about card playing, but dancing. And he called one of the servants and he asked what these things meant. And he said, "Your brother has come and your father," he reminds him of his identity. "Your brother and your father," these key relationships in his life. "Your father's killed the fatted calf because he received him back safe and sound." And he was angry. Great word here in Greek. It means explosive rage. He was mad. And he refused to go in. Kill the calf? How about kill him? Kill him. Deuteronomy 20:18, the rebellious son should be stoned. So what happened? His father came out. So the father comes out for the younger son. The father also comes out to appeal to the older son. He entreats him to grasp, not grumble about grace, to rejoice and stop pouting and fuming. But the son answered the father, "Look," the sense here is, "Now you look here. You look here. These many years I served you. I deserve your love for all of my accomplishments. And I never disobeyed your commandments and my moral righteousness. Yet you never gave me a young goat, let alone a fat cow, that I might celebrate with my friends." He doesn't want to celebrate with dad and brother. "But when this son of yours," not this brother of mine, "came back home who devoured your property with prostitutes," after he did that and more, I'm sure, at least that's what I think, because that's what I would do if I was him, "you killed the fatted calf for him." And again, look at the final verses, verses 31, 32. The father embraces him, "Son," technia. It's a word that means little child, little child. "You're always with me, and all that is mine is yours." So once again, he entreats him, he embraces him, and then he entreats him. "It was fitting," or it can be translated, we'll have to change the bulletin covers, "it is necessary. It is necessary to celebrate and be glad. Joy is the only option here, son. For your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and he is found." I asked for Rembrandt's famous Return of the Prodigal Son to be the bulletin cover this morning. Thank you, Katie, for your extra labors. Because in this masterpiece, one of the Dutch artist's final paintings, likely completed right before he died in 1669, Rembrandt perfectly depicts the characters, or he does a good job depicting them. The prodigal has on a tattered robe, needs a new one, looks altogether unkept. He has one shoe half off and another shoe gone. He has a shaved head, which means he was working as a slave. And his repentance is expressed in his posture before the Father. He's on his knees and he's leaning towards him. Let's imitate him. Let's imitate him. Let's repent. That is, when we sin, let's turn away from sin and turn back to the Father. Then there's the Father, whose face and hands, two things that are hard to draw well, perfectly depict God's tender love and his embrace, his offer of forgiveness and acceptance. Let's thank him and let's imitate him. Let's get grace and let's give grace to one another. And finally, there's the older brother, the one standing tall and overlooking this sad, to him, this sad scene. Notice how well-dressed he is, but also notice his face and hands. He looks proud, and he looks down in judgment. And his hands also suggest the same. They're folded as to say, no, not me. I won't stoop down. I'm not going to open my arms to this scoundrel. Let's not imitate him. The church needs less self-righteous, arrogant, stingy, self-pitying, resentful, proud, bitter, unrepentant, unforgiving people who only celebrate their own achievements. Am I right? Instead, let's rejoice and be glad when a sinner repents of whatever sin. Let's embrace him or accept him. Throw a forgiveness party. Let's join the angels in our Father's joy in heaven. You see, what is different or most different about these three lost, found, celebrate parables in Luke 15 is that the parable of the prodigal son has an inconclusive ending and one that doesn't focus on the father or the son, these two very important characters, because they're off enjoying themselves, eating the best steak. They're drinking their fill from the never-ending keg of grace. But the older brother is who it focuses on. What does he think at this point in the story? Will he respond to the father's invitation to celebrate? You see, this open-ended invitation, or ending, is an invitation to everyone who doesn't like the God of grace and who doesn't like his son Jesus, who came not only to receive sinners, but to eat with them, to fellowship forever with them. It's an invitation to run to the Father as he runs to you. It is an invitation to embrace grace. Let's pray. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me and many of us here today. We once were lost, but are now found. And Lord, we rejoice in that salvation. We thank you for all the ways in which you have worked in our lives to bring us to salvation and beyond that. And Lord, we are so delighted that we get to come to the table now and have this feast, this tangible reminder of how much you love us in Christ. So we thank you, Father, Son, and Spirit, in Jesus' name, amen. So we come now to the table. I invite you to just take a moment of silence to think upon, meditate upon what you've just heard, and then we'll together participate in the Lord's Supper. My brothers and sisters, as we draw near to the Lord's table, we draw near, in Paul's words, to celebrate his death, but also to celebrate the forgiveness of sins. And we're grateful to remember why Jesus instituted this ordinance or the sacrament. A number of different reasons. Here are a few of them. For the perpetual memory of his dying for our sakes and a pledge of his undying love towards us. This meal also represents a bond of our union with him and a bond, a mystical union with one another as Christ's body on earth. It is a seal of his promises to us, a renewal for us of our obedience to him. We're pledging, yes, I want to follow Jesus. And it's for the blessed assurance of his presence to those who are gathered in his name. It's an opportunity for us who love the Savior to feed on him spiritually, as he is the bread of life. And it's a pledge of his coming again. Well, may the Holy Spirit minister these truths to us as we come now to partake. Please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we celebrate now this meal which you prepared for us, a heavenly meal which reminds us of earthly realities, this bread and this cup, which are tangible and visible reminders of our sin, but also the supreme sacrifice of your Son, his body broken, his blood shed for us and for our salvation. And so, Lord, we ask, as we take time now to meditate upon these realities, the realities of our sin and of our salvation, and then as we somberly, but joyously partake of this meal, we ask that you'd help us now to confess our sins and also to acknowledge our indebtedness to your free grace. Amen. I want to remind you that this is a meal for those who believe in Christ, those who acknowledge him as their Savior and their Lord. If that's not who you are at this point, we pray and we hope that you'll come to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And at that time, we invite you to partake with us. And as believers, we are called to examine our hearts. It's a great time, as the elements are being passed out, to confess any unknown sins since you haven't already confessed. And as we partake the elements together, we ask that you would hold them, and then as the elders come back, we'll partake in unison.
Be
On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat in remembrance of him." Pray now for the cup. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you so loved us. You sent Jesus Christ to suffer, to bleed, and to die for us. As we partake of this juice in remembrance of his sacrifice, Lord, may you remind us of the depths of his love for us. We pray this in his name. Amen. Jesus' blood was poured out for all our sins. Drink this in memory of his great sacrifice.
Please stand as we sing our closing hymn, our hymn of response, "All I Have is Christ."
I once was lost.
May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with every good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. May be seated.